Thanks to Frank, who accepted to come with a lot of enthusiasm. So Frank is a professor at the University College of London. He's a senior member of the Institut Universitaire de France. He has been working on business cycles and the role of expectations on business cycle. And today he's going to talk about monetary policy when the Phillips curve is locally quite flat. So he's going to have about 1 hour, and then there will be a discussion by Xavier Ago, in principle, even if he's not here yet. But we are, again, very happy to have Frank. So Frank, the floor is yours. You have about 1 hour. Thank you.
Merci, Francesco. Thanks for having me. It's a great pleasure to be here. Yes, good to see real people. Although maybe we will pay the consequence of it later in the week. But anyway, it's, as far as now, it's great. So this is a joint work with Paul, which is now the Bank of Canada, and Chen, who is student at with grad student at in Vancouver. And this paper is, I mean, it's a very monetary policy paper, so I guess it's good for this circumstance. Okay. So we're basically, so there was an intro which was great just before like the COVID-19, but as many other things, you know, you might want to adapt it a little bit. So we used to say, you know, nowadays inflation is super low, below target, and at the same time, unemployment is very low. That's not the case anymore, but that's, you know, that was the case. So it's still interesting. You know, dinosaurs are interesting, and lowflation is, I guess, is still interesting. Okay, so how can we make sense of, you know, a lot of things that seem to go wrong with inflation in the typical kind of New Keynesian model? Like, as I said, those periods of lowflation with like super lax monetary policy, low unemployment, but nevertheless below target inflation. But, you know, also things like, you know, missing deflation, which is perhaps just the reverse of it. Also issues about missing volatility of inflation at the ZLB. Perhaps, you know, I don't know about that, but I guess it's something we can discuss later. But you know, is there some kind of like some kind of missing inflation? Is there some kind of missing inflation nowadays? You know, it seems that inflation seems to be pretty low, given that there's at the same time a negative supply shock and super lax monetary policy again. You know, and then the price puzzle, which is a whole thing. So there's a lot of things that are kind of like a bit like accord with inflation in the New Keynesian model. So what we want to do is to basically revisit all those things, you know, looking at a model which is going to be, oops, slightly different from the one we used to study, but not really. So that's the point. We're not doing anything. We're not, you know, anything particularly smart, at least to start with. After that, I hope it's at least interesting. So what we do is that we explore the consequences of having a cost channel of monetary policy. So I will define that. This is a little bit of jargon here. And this is not new at all. And we explore the consequences of this cost channel, in particular when the Phillips curve is kind of flat. We'll show that you know, in this configuration, you know, things are very different as far as monetary policy is concerned. I'll explain. I'll show that in the data, indeed, the Phillips curve is basically flat, even worse. I mean, but let's say flat, and I mean by worse, I mean it basically has the wrong slope. And there's a cost channel which is relatively important. So you know, all the like the theory we kind of like bringing is basically relevant for, at least for the US. We haven't yet worked on other countries, but I mean, I don't know for other countries. Okay, so that's so what do we do? So the first thing we do, and you know, it's like in a way, I mean, you know it's everything is there. Okay, so what happens when, you know, in the Phillips curve, the marginal cost is a function not only of, you know, the output gap y, but also on the real interest rate. Okay, so it's obvious that, I mean, it's obvious, relatively obvious to believe that, you know, there are some financial costs for firms, so that, you know, the interest rate should enter in the cost function. So just one thing, you know, one caveat. this why in the marginal cost, I mean, this marginal cost is not really the marginal cost, right? It's really the, it's how the marginal cost is affected by a deviation between the flex price and fixed price allocations, right? So even when I say, if I say the Phillips curve is flat, you don't see the output gap in the in the marginal cost. That doesn't mean that labor is free, right? It doesn't just mean that in deviations, this has no inflation pressures. Okay, so what we find here is that when this gamma y, which is what we call the slope of the Phillips curve, right, meaning how inflation moves with the output gap, everything else being constant. So when this guy is small and kind of small compared to the other one, the gamma r, which is the size of the cost channel, okay, and then I'll show you the exact condition. It's there's something else involved, but anyway. So we find that the model looks like very different when we're in this configuration. Okay, fine, so good so far. But is that interesting? Is that empirically relevant? And then we try to spend quite a lot of effort on showing that, indeed, this is what we have in the data. And we do that in two ways. One way is, you don't have to believe in DSGs, in like three equations models. Let's do something which might be a bit less sophisticated, but perhaps more robust, who knows, which is just estimating a Phillips curve. So I'm not going to tell you that there's a lot done there. And so this, we're just going to estimate Phillips curve. Do it in the best possible way. And what we do find is that, basically the Phillips curve is flat. It's flat meaning that, the output gap doesn't enter in the Phillips curve. And this gamma R, which is like the effect of the real interest rate on inflation, is positive and significant. Okay? So that doesn't mean that in equilibrium, things will be, an increase in the real interest rate will decrease inflation. That's just along the Phillips curve. Okay? And then what we do also is that we also, because this is how we're going to start, write down a more kind of like general equilibrium model with some sticky prices in which you're going to have a Phillips curve of that type, and then we're going to estimate the whole model using some full information method, and then we're going to find again sorry, that this gamma y is zero and that this gamma r is positive. So in plain words, the fact that the Phillips curve is flat. And the real interest rate matter for inflation, okay? And so this will, in a way, I could have presented things the other way around, but anyway. So I'm gonna like first show you that, if this this condition between gamma y and gamma r is true, then a lot of interesting things happen, and then I'll show you that it's indeed what you find in the data. Okay, and then we conclude that, this is what I just said. Okay, so is there, any question at this stage that I might clarify? Okay, please, I didn't say that, but please stop me as much as needed. Okay, let me do the theory. I will not spend any time on the micro foundations of the model because it's like, if you know, if you don't know like the kind of new Keynesian type three equation type of model, 1 hour is not enough perhaps. And if you know it, that's going to be like some tiny variation of it. So I don't think it's like very relevant. But there's nothing deep. Let me tell you what is the reduced form, and I'll tell you what we do. So here are like the two equations that are important. One is like this kind of the Euler equation, like the demand equation. So one likes to call it, and the other one is the Phillips curve, okay? And we do one important change, and one very marginal. So, and they're in red. So the first thing I said it already, we had this, the real interest rate in the marginal cost, okay? And then here the marginal cost again is with the quote, because it's like, it's the deviation from the flex price equilibrium, okay? And this equation is just telling us that that inflation is discounted sum of future marginal costs. And then the first one is just equation. And the only thing that we might need at some point is that this alpha y is like smaller than one. Okay, so if you write down the model, like the plain model, this alpha y is one, And but then, you know, some people have worked on trying to kind of look at cases where the self-hour is less than one. It's called like discounted unit equation. So it could be either you know, like behavioral, or it could be like financial market frictions. So in the model, we have some, we have a little bit of asymmetry of information, and that in repay, you know, for repaying the debt, and that generates this alpha. So it's kind of like fully microfunded. But if you like another microfoundation, you know, I'm fine as far as you have this guy here. And it can, you know, in what we do, it could be as, you know, arbitrarily close to one, but not exactly one. So essentially, it's pretty relevant, but you know, formally we need to put, I would prefer not to put it, but anyway, but that's not important. The other one is, which is important, is this gamma r, but that's obvious, you know, this is since forever, but in the modern incarnation of this literature, I guess Ravenna and Walsh perhaps, or you know, kind of like introduce this kind of like cost channel. And what is important is that, so the way we have it in the model is that, you know, you need to borrow for intermediate goods, and then so you need to pay a financial cost because you need first to borrow, then get the intermediate goods, then produce and then sell. And you know, this kind of like a bit like in a convoluted story is such that, you know, gamma y and gamma r, let's say that, you know, you normalize them to sum to one, they can be anywhere between 0 and 1. Okay, that's, whereas, you know, most of the literature has looked at very specific cases where there are like some strong restrictions between gamma y and gamma r. Typically, gamma y is gamma equal gamma r. Okay. So, but you know, so that's what I want you to take as the, you know, as the basics of the model. Yes.
Hey, Hobbs. The question might be completely wrong, but I was wondering about the link between the expression you wrote there for the Phillips curve and the Taylor rule, because in a sense that rates, inflation, and output. Right. The Taylor rule will tell you when inflation is high, interest rates are going to go up, and this one also has a positive view.
So here it's, you know, it's about behavior. So, you know, so I'm kind of like writing down what's the optimal behavior of the household, you know, given constraints, etc. This, it gives me the first equation, given prices, meaning given inflation and the nominal interest rate. The second equation is, you know, basically telling me what's the optimal behavior of firms given interest rate and given the prices of others, right? And so here, so I'm missing one equation that will be like an equation pinning down the real or the nominal interest rate. Okay. But that's, you know, so in equilibrium, everything will depend on everything. But here it's really like along, it's what you get out of the optimal pricing decisions of firms, right? So this holds regardless of monetary policy. Of course, the equilibrium relations between the variables will depend, you know, big time on monetary policy. But you know, those equations, they are like structural, right? They are always true.
It also distinguishes the naive estimation.
But that's gonna be okay. Sure.
If you plug into the rule, you will get the parameter on output actually is part flat.
Sure.
Part.
No, sure. That's, you know, that's the big thing with estimating, you know, Phillips curves alone. You need to identify, and then, you know, you need to do it properly. So one way to do it properly is to have a fully specified model and do full information. But then if your model is misspecified, you're off. So, you know, so that's the trade off. So we're doing both, trying to come with a I think relatively convincing identification strategy. But yeah, sure, absolutely. But here it's theory, so it's fine. We know everything. All right. So nothing really, you know, nothing spectacular here. And let me just, you know, to make sure that we are on the same line. So if you have alpha y is one, and gamma r, which is the effect of the real interest rate in the cost of firms, equals zero, then you're back to, you know, Galli's textbook. Okay. So and this alpha y is, you know, if you want to think that it's one, you know, I'm happy with that. Okay, so now let me come up with a condition which has a very simple interpretation, condition parameters, and that will happen to be key for generating like kind of interesting behavior of the equilibrium. Okay, so now, okay, so we're going to call this condition the Patman condition after this guy, Congressman Wright Patman, which was not such a nice guy, but anyway. So you know, so in the 70s, he was like, you know, pushing a critique of the Fed, which was of the type, oh, you know, inflation is high and the Fed is increasing interest rate. By increasing interest rate, the Fed is increasing the cost of firms. The firms will pass the cost on their price. So basically, it's like throwing gasoline on fire. So it's called, that's not what one should do. And so that's, you know, that has been, for some reason, this is very often mentioned to us like the populist critique to the Fed policy. You know, so I'm not sure if we are populist or not. But according to Tobin, at least we are like heretics, you know. So we're gonna, okay. So that's the kind of thing that Patman was pushing, and which is like possible, at least, you know, maybe not in equilibrium, but that's something which is possible. So let me do something which is, you know, means not to be anything relevant in equilibrium, but let me take this model and given expectations. So I'm not changing expectations. Okay. Given expectation, let me look at the impact of an increase in the real interest rate. So everywhere you see R, you can think of I minus ET of pi t plus 1, right? That's the real interest rate. So let me think of what happens if I increase the real interest rate by 1%, keeping expectations constant. So you see that the effect on inflation is positive via the cost channel, okay? Because the real interest rate enters into the cost of firms. So the inflation will increase by gamma R. But at the same time, by increasing the interest rate, you're kind of like pushing down demand on the first equation by alpha R. And when demand goes down, inflation goes down, right? So you see that there's a positive direct effect of an increase in the interest rate on inflation, which is gamma R. And there's a negative indirect effect, which is minus alpha R times gamma Y. Is that clear? It's, you know, it's really you fix this thing here, and you just replace Y by minus alpha R, and then you get minus alpha R times gamma Y plus gamma R times R. Okay, so what I'm going to call the Patman condition is the case where increasing the interest rate, keeping expectation constant, is increasing inflation. So you know, so this can happen. Maybe increasing expectation, maybe keeping expectation constant is like crazy because it's not an equilibrium outcome. But you know, maybe it is. So I can tell you easily an economy in which it is an equilibrium outcome. That economy is completely forward looking. If all shocks are IID, all expectations are always zero. Okay, so they are kept constant. So in an economy which is in an economy which is IID. You know, if you increase R by 1%, let's on impact, inflation will vary by gamma R minus alpha R gamma Y. Okay. So then, of course, you know, if shocks are persistent, you know, things are more complicated. But that's the kind of condition that we will have all the time, right? So is the strength of the cost channel strong compared to the slope of the Phillips curve? But you know, like. Strong, I mean, but in relative terms, what matters because there is this alpha R in between. And just to give you an idea of what you can find, so the idea that those two numbers are like super small, like the gamma Y, we know perhaps the Phillips curve is flat and therefore this gamma Y is zero, perhaps a little bit negative, a little bit positive. This gamma R will also be relatively small. So basically, we're trying to see whether, you know, a zero divided by zero is zero or plus infinity. So it's very easy to go one way or another. I mean, maybe it's not the good way to tell it because it looks like as if anything could happen. But then we're gonna check that, you know, in a statistically significant way, things are one way or another. But you know, that's the kind of idea. Okay. So as I said, okay. If you have ID shocks, that's exactly the, you know, the equilibrium response of inflation. So now, so this Patman condition, let me try to convince you that it cannot hold globally. That cannot be that, you know, no matter what, either the real interest rate has a positive or a negative effect on inflation. So, you know, let's assume, you know, let's do a reductio ad absurdum. Let's assume that gamma R is exactly equal to alpha R gamma Y, so that the impact of inflation, of the real interest rate on inflation is zero. Okay, and let's assume that the world is linear. It means that it will be all the time zero. So it means that typically the central bank could decrease the output gap as much as wanted without any impact on inflation. it seems obvious that at some point, you know, inflationary pressures will start kicking in just because resources are scarce. You know, the labor market will be like, will become like super tight and so on and so forth. So the idea is that, it's not reasonable to assume that, you know, this marginal cost function is linear. And it has to be that, you know, when the output gap is super low, this gamma is like very, very low. Well, okay, output gap is minus, okay, so it's the other way around, okay? Let me think that it is the unemployment rate. It's going to be easier for me. So when the unemployment rate is super low, you expect inflationary pressures more than, you know, at the steady state. And when unemployment is super high, you expect very low inflation, right? Okay. And then you have to kind of flip it with output. Okay. So the idea is that what we really have is that, okay. So it's pretty, I mean, it's kind of likely, this is what we're going to assume, that at the steady state, those inflationary forces, the slope of the Phillips curve is minimum, but then if you go far away enough, it becomes, you know, negative again. Okay. Negative in this plane. Okay. All right. And then, you know, there's a question which is, okay, is there some kind of global Padman condition? Can it be the case that no matter what, when I increase the interest rate, I always increase or decrease inflation? And the answer is no. I mean, the answer is if you go far away enough, for sure, the Padman condition will not hold. Okay. Because this gamma Y will become very large. The Phillips curve will become very steep, right? If we are like 15% below the steady state or 15% above, they're going to be like inflationary or deflationary forces. It's really more like close to the steady state that things can be a bit more interesting. Okay. So, okay. Let me skip that. So then something I'm not showing here is that, so when you look at this economy and then I will look at either a case where the Padman condition holds or doesn't hold. Okay. And if you want to think, you know, Padman condition holds means that, increasing the interest rate has a strong effect on the cost of firms and therefore is passed to inflation. If you look at the response of the economy to a demand shock or a markup shock, you don't see any difference. I mean, it's qualitatively the same. So there's no way you can tell, you know, whether this condition holds or not looking at those responses. But as far as monetary policy is concerned, as far as monetary shocks are concerned, you know, the economy behaves very differently depending on whether or not we're under this condition. So this is what I'm going to explore now. And it matters for a lot of things. So in the paper, we have more than this, but I'm going to basically discuss, you know, how to stabilize inflation and how the way one can stabilize inflation matters. I mean, it depends a lot on the parameter configuration. And I'm going to quickly talk about the ZLB trap and the price puzzle if I have time. Okay. So here's what I want to do. So here what I'm doing is that I'm keeping the model linear everywhere except for this gamma of y for the slope. Okay. So you might say, well, but that's crazy. You know, either you're in a linear world or in a nonlinear world. You know. So that's here. I mean, what's the issue? Let's first look at, you know, that particular nonlinearity, which is the one that we're interested in. We don't see particular reasons why other nonlinearities will exactly offset that one. That might be the case. And, you know, but, you know, this is typically same type of approach that we do when we look at a linear model plus a ZLB, right? So the model is linear everywhere except where it's not. Fine. Anyway, so this is what we do. And because it's easy, there's no other reason. And let me look at a positive demand shock or a positive markup shock. And let me look at a monetary policy as the following thing. I'm increasing the interest rate for capital N period. And then I go back to zero. Why I'm doing this? Because then I can solve everything analytically. Okay. So that's my policy. My policy is increase R for capital N period and go back to zero. R is the real interest rate. And then the question is, okay, what should I do when there is a shock in order to stabilize inflation? So, okay, that's the formula, but you know, it's not like, it's not going to be very useful. So let me do this. And let me look at, okay, let me do this. So what is that? So this is the the equilibrium locus between the real interest rate and inflation once you have solved all the model. Okay? And this guy is nonlinear and negatively sloped when we are not under the Patman condition. That's the New Keynesian model, you know, the Galilei's New Keynesian model, right? Except that it's linear. So what does it mean? So let's assume that the economy is here at the steady state, and then you have like a positive shock to demand, say, okay? Positive shock to demand, keeping the interest rate constant is pushing up inflation, okay? And then what does the typical monetary policy analysis suggest? Oh, that's a case where, you know, monetary authorities need to cool down the economy in order to bring back inflation to target. So this is what you do here. Instead of B, you increase R. So here, I'm looking at monetary policy as directly choosing the real interest rate. So I'm choosing R, and by choosing R, which is larger, I move from B to C. So I'm kind of pushing back inflation to target, closer to carrier. That's obvious, right? Maybe we don't look at it on this graph generally, but that's the typical thing. So now let me look at what happens when we are, okay, another thing. If you really want to see, like, let me add like monetary policy, that would be, say, interest rate is a function of inflation, right? And psi, which is that slope, is like the aggressiveness of the policy, right? If the policy is very, if psi is large, the policy is very aggressive. When inflation increases a little bit, I'm increasing a lot the interest rate. And you see that here, by having a more aggressive monetary policy, you're kind of like stabilizing inflation, right? This black line here will slope like will rotate that way downwards, and the response of inflation will be lower. That's amazing. So now let me show you what happens when you have this Patman condition. So this Patman condition is telling you, in equilibrium, where you increase your interest rate, you increase inflation. That's, this is what I told you. I told you the condition is keeping expectation fixed, but you can basically also kind of write the implication of this condition for once expectations are endogenous. And so here, you're in the case where, in this zone, we know that, everything, that's the Patman thing, If you want to basically stabilize inflation by increasing your interest rate, you're kind of like throwing gasoline on fire, okay? So here's what you do. If you increase, let's say that you have this kind of demand or markup shock. So here I'm doing the markup shock because it's a simple translation, because the nonlinearity, the demand shock is doing something which is a little bit harder to draw, but it's the same, exactly the same logic. So there is this markup shock, more inflation in fact. And now if you react to this more inflation so basically there's a markup shock. And then you react, you increase a little bit the real interest rate. This is kind of pushing even further up the marginal cost so that inflation is increasing. Okay. And then you need to do like a big increase of, you need to do a big policy, kind of like a very bold policy in order to kind of stabilize inflation by basically reaching the zone where the Phillips curve is again sloping the right way, if you want. Okay. And then how far is this? I don't know. I mean, I'll show you some estimations, but the idea is that what we find is that this zone here is pretty large. Okay, I'll show you. So that's a very different way of thinking of, what monetary policy should do to stabilize inflation. So typically, to put it, the other way around, I'll talk about that later, but if I don't have time. So think of like the ZLB. So if you have like a big negative demand shock, okay, so you have like basically a downward pressure on inflation. And if the central bank is basically adopting lax monetary policy in order to help the economy recovery, that's going to push inflation even further down. So it's going to have exactly the opposite effect to the effect that we think is the right effect in the New Keynesian model. And so basically, the lower inflation, the more you have lax monetary policy, the lower inflation, and then you kind of like almost endogenously end up at the ZLB. And if you can think of many examples of such situations. So that's something which is like pretty different depending on whether we have like the patent condition. So let me skip. Oh, this, yeah, this, let me skip this. So this is what I just explained quickly. Let me also skip that thing. But so we prove that typically, if you're under the patent condition, you have a price puzzle when you look at the effect of monetary policy. I'm sorry, the effect of monetary policy shock. Okay, so it's going to push up inflation. Yeah, at least in the short run, which is what we find in the data. But you know, to have it, yeah. Okay, that's okay. So there are some other predictions that we have. You know, like various things like the volatility of inflation. Why is inflation less volatile at the ZLB, contrarily to what is suggested by the model, where the Patman condition doesn't hold, and so on and so forth. But let me skip that part, and let me go to the empirical part, where I would like to kind of like convince you that this configuration of parameters seems to be the one we find, at least in US data. We haven't yet looked at other economies. Any questions at this stage? You know, I went a bit fat, but you know, like, so micro foundations, you forget it. So then you have like the two equations that are like super familiar. Forget the Euler discounting. And so, and then, you know, think of like the relative strength of those two effects and how it completely changed the way we think of the effect of the interest rate on inflation and of lax or tight monetary policy on inflation. Okay, all right. So now I want to go to the estimation. First, you know, I don't know. Of course, you know, it depends a lot on, you know, the audience, whether some people, you know, don't even want to pay attention to Phillips curve estimations if it's not in a fully specified general equilibrium model. Other ones, on the contrary, you know, I mean, they don't believe in anything which is like kind of like general equilibrium. So I wouldn't, you know, they wouldn't like to have any to get to have anything being imposed by some crazy three equation general equilibrium model. So you know, obviously the truth is somewhere in the middle. So let me first show you the Phillips curve estimation. Okay, so that's what we want to estimate. So we have like inflation, expected inflation, like the output gap effect on inflation, the real interest rate effect on inflation, maybe, you know, some extra shocks, like, you know, I don't know, oil shocks, something like that, and then some markup, some epsilon to that curve, which we call markup shock. Okay? All right. So here, it's obvious that you cannot identify separately the kappa and the gammas, right? If you think that the kappa is more something which is related to the, like, you know, like the Calvo lambda or this kind of thing, and then the gammas are more like the elasticity of the marginal cost to the price of factors, if you want. Well, here you cannot separate the two. So let me get rid of the kappa. It's going to be one. Okay. This is without, of course, without lots of generality. You know, the problem is this: why? That's the output gap, right? That's really like the distance between the flex price and fixed price output, which we don't know. So we need to kind of like, you know, proxy it by something. So we're not going to do anything fancy here. You know, take any like measure, not any, but we're going to take one of the measure of the output gap that is out there. And we take several, but that's a, you know, kind of like a difficulty before you start identifying already. And then, you know, the third difficulty is that we need like expected inflation. So do we have expected inflation? Or either we try to look for, you know, measures of expected inflation, either we assume rational expectations and then we kind of like make use of it in order to get rid of this. You know, we're going to do it both ways because literature has gone both ways. But that's the third difficulty. So let me, you know, call this guy here pi e, the expected inflation. So this is what we want to estimate, right? And then, you know, once, so what we're going to do, so pi t, that will be typically headline CPI. I mean, we do like several things, but you know, let's say the baseline is like headline CPI. This pi e would be like your typical, like, you know, the Michigan Survey of Consumer measure of expected inflation. So it's indeed, you know, expected inflation as reported by households. XT, we're going to take like minus the unemployment gap. And that unemployment gap is computed by the US CBO. Yeah, good or bad. I mean, that's, and then ZT, we're going to control, you know, we're going to put like all prices everywhere. Okay. So that's the first like layer of difficulties, which, you know, okay, you already have to make choices here. We do like zillions of robustness analysis. But now, you know, of course, you know, that the big problem, as we discussed before, is now is also endogeneity. Because, right, this is like, you know, there are like some other, there are other equations there. And so what we, so let me check that I get it right. Yeah, we want to look at the movements of the variables along that equation, right, in order to identify the parameters, right? But we don't want the economy to be moved by the mu, because if it's moved by the mu, we cannot identify the, so we kind of like, we want to have like variations in pi, expected inflation, output gap, and the interest rate that are coming from elsewhere. Okay, good. Right. So typically, so X is endogenous. You know, obviously that's different from those Phillips curves that don't have a real interest rate. The real interest rate is endogenous because, of course, you know, monetary policy is reacting to the state of the economy. And expected inflation, you know, I mean, everything is endogenous, you know, obviously. So that's the cool thing with using like the three equations is that, you know, then everything is identified. That's fine. I mean, everything is identified, potentially. Here, it's like, so here we're going to do, you know, the best we can, and which is like more or less the best people have done in the past. So let me go through, you know, in steps. So first, what we could do, you know, this is what I guess a master student would do, or maybe a bachelor student. You just like, you know, you just, you know. So let me at least take the measure of expected inflation. So I have the series, and I just like, you know, put all the variables there, and I estimate by OLS. Okay. So I do as if I don't have any identification problem. So here, what is, and then let me forget for the moment like the real interest rate, the cost part. So I'm going to get the Phillips curve, which looks like a Phillips curve. You know, there's the slope, this gamma y is the slope, is positive significant. Right. So I might say, oh, you know, here, let's say, you know, so there's a whole literature, like I'm thinking of, you know, Quabon, Gorodichenko, that thinks that they don't need to instrument expectations because they're already kind of measured in the data. So there's no need to, I'm not sure I understand, you know, like the logic, but. Let's say, you know, as far as I have like survey measures for expectations, I don't need to instrument anymore. So let's do that. I think it's silly, but anyway, doesn't matter much in the end. So that's what we do. So the second line is like, you know, Quabon and Gorodichenko, basically. You instrument the gap, and you instrument the gap not in a particular smart way. You do kind of like Clarida Galli. You just use lags of the gap. It's not right, but that's what you can do. And then you find basically the same thing. So this gamma y is positive and significant. So the Phillips curve has a positive slope. And then you move to, you just add the, now you can say, okay, let me look at the last column. So the last column is I'm putting like everything and I am instrumenting for both the real interest rate and for the gap. And the way I instrument for the real interest rate, that's something which is like much better and something that has been used by Barnichon and I forgot the name of the other guy, but Mertens perhaps, or anyway, Mertens. Okay, so you use basically Romer and Romer monetary policy shocks as an instrument for the interest rate, for the policy variable. And when you do that, here's what you get, and that's going to be something we're going to, that's the last column, something that's going to be consistent, that we will obtain consistently. The Phillips curve is flat. You see that the gamma y is not significant, and then the gamma r, you know, the cost channel is there, about 0.2, whatever it means. I mean, you have to kind of think of what it is. It's a it's a it's a I don't know how it's called, an elasticity, I'm not sure. It's rights to rights, so it's just a derivative. Yes?
This is a quite long sample, so are you essentially telling us that the Patman condition holds globally?
Well, on average, I would say. This is literally what it means. That doesn't mean it's all the time, but it holds, at the mean or something on average, right? That's what it means. I mean, literally. So I'll show you. Yeah, okay. I'll show you like some nonlinear estimations because, here it's easy. So we did it. When it's looking at the full equilibrium model, we didn't do it. Perhaps we should, but okay. Okay. So here it's on. It means on average, from I forgot to say, 69 to 2015. That's the Patman condition holds. I mean, in periods where you are like super low or super high, maybe that doesn't hold. Okay. So now, here you can do, the other thing you can do is try to, either use the Michigan survey measure of expectation or use rational expectations, and then put here realized inflation and then instrument also for expectations. So we do that and we use unless you ask me, questions about the details, I won't give you any details here. Maybe it's a bit boring, but it's this kind of thing. When you look at it from the outside, I hope I'm not offended anymore. It looks like super boring. It's like national accounts. But once you start like looking at it more carefully, it's great, right? Right. Okay. So again, once we think we instrument in the maximum possible way things, we get that. This gamma R is there and it's big compared to this gamma Y, the slope of the Phillips curve, which is non-significantly different from zero. Yes?
On this, I think it would be interesting to show at least the first stages of the instrument, even if we do not really believe they are good, because maybe that's just the result of the strength of the instrument.
Okay.
If the Rummer is a very good instrument, actually you get bad. The instrument you're using for the optical gap is not good.
Okay.
You can only use both instruments for both variables. Maybe you tried all these.
Yeah. And so in the paper, There are zillions of statistics at the end that at some point Sev produced using Stata. I have no clue what they are, but they're supposed to do everything, to say everything about the validity of each instrument. But of course they are not reported there because it's and on top of that I'm not sure I remember exactly how to read that. But we did that. That's the idea, that except for The ones which are a bit fishy are really like the lags of the output gap. That's something which is like pretty known. The Romer and Romer, as you said, is a very good instrument. And then we did all the things where instrument one and not the other. So it's not a great answer, but I think that we try to do well on that front. But I forgot. There are like some statistics I discovered there, so I forgot. Some kind of statistic for the validity of the instrument. But I should, okay. Next time I'll have a better answer. Okay. So you can do then, of course, let me not do that, but you can try to have to put a little bit more dynamics into the equation. And typically what people do is that at least they have the persistence of inflation, the lag of inflation entering the equation. You get the same thing. More interesting, so sometimes people think, if you do the before 92, say, we know for sure that's a period in which, there's a stable and kind of positive slope Phillips curve. That's not what you get if you also, put the reinforcement rate. You basically get a Phillips curve, which is flat as far as the output gap is concerned. Of course, things are complicated because the reinforcement rate is itself, endogenous, right? So we're trying to, you see what I mean? But that's once properly instrumented. So it's not something which has to do with, so the thing we haven't done also because, but I'm sure someone did because, it's basic data mining, but I haven't found, people kind of systematically showing that the interest rate is powerful variable in order to explain inflation, predict inflation, blah blah blah. I'm sure, Laura, that you know a lot about that, but I haven't found like a paper where it was said, coming. Well, it's clear that we forgot the interest rate in the Phillips curve, and that's super important to explain this or that. Should be there. Okay, so that's okay. So if you take all the possible combination of samples, variables, blah blah blah, you end up having 1,000 estimations, and I'm not sure this means anything, but it's kind of okay. And what? And then you see that when it's dark, it means that when it's dark, it means that the cost is insignificant. When it's black, only the cost. When it's black, the two channels are significant. When it's dark, it's only the cost channel. And then here you would like to draw a line that would depend on this this extra alpha that we had in the condition, and depending on if you assume something reasonable, that that's the elasticity of consumption to the interest rate. That's, let's say, one. It's much lower than one, but let's say it's one. And if you put a one somewhere here, you would keep like a lot of the. Okay, anyway, so you see that it's relatively hard to get a gamma. This is not gamma L. So that should be a gamma Y. I'm sorry. Everywhere, gamma L should be gamma Y. Sorry about that. And anyway, so you see. Okay, last thing to have a sense of the nonlinearity. Let me now re-estimate this, but just add a cubic term for the output gap, where I want to put the nonlinearity. So what do you get? And then let me do the exactly the Patman condition. Given expectations, how does pi t respond to r along this equation? Okay, and this is how it works. And so you see that basically you find that when the interest rate is somewhere in between, say 300% basis point below and 300% above the steady state, then an increase in the real interest rate is basically decreasing inflation and not the opposite. Is increasing inflation and the opposite. Okay? That's the kind of idea. So that's the kind of range to answer your question on whether it holds all the time, not all the time. So you would need real interest rate to be relatively away from the steady state. I don't know what's the steady state. Of course, maybe you would need a model in which you have regimes in the natural rates. I'm sure we could try to do better with that. Okay, good. Now, let me look at the full information case. And here I can show, it's a bit more fragile in the sense that there's a lot of assumptions. I'm going to use a model which is three equations to explain the world. But at least I know what's the identification. Okay, so here's that's the model we estimate. So that's the first equation, that's what it is. The second one also. And then we also need, we discussed that at the beginning, we need also a policy rule. So here is what we do. We write the monetary policy the following way. The central bank chooses the real interest rate, I minus ET of pi t plus 1, to react to shocks. Okay? So it looks like a little bit bizarre. I don't know. I think it's super cool. Because once you have this, you can substitute the I into the first equation. And then in the I minus E of pi in the first equation, and you can solve for Y. So you get the economy becomes a complicated dichotomy. So why is that a good, and then two, in that economy, if alpha Y is strictly smaller than one, that economy is always determinate regardless of the values of the parameters, which is also very cool. So now, you might say, I want a Taylor rule with, I want to find 1.25 and 0.5 or I don't know. Well, okay, so there's a theorem. Let me call it a theorem because, I hope it's going to close the possible discussions. There's a theorem that says that if you write down a Taylor rule that provides determinacy, then the allocations you obtain can be obtained with that particular rule. Okay, so this is not restrictive when estimating. If the world is a Taylor rule that gives determinacy, you're going to find it. But on top of that, you might find allocations that cannot be produced in a unique way by a tailor. Okay? In case it's... okay. So it's... I think one should always estimate models with such policy because it's, you know, it's less restrictive. So there's no reason why being more restrictive. And I'll show you that. And, you know, you have this... quite quickly. You know, for people like me who are not like super, let's put it like in a nice way, super interested in writing like thousands of lines of code, I like, you know, using dinar to estimation. Problem with dinar is that, you know, so you might want to estimate a model that is indeterminate, right? So you put a Taylor rule and you would like dinar to tell you, oh, you're in the zone where the equilibrium is indeterminate. I mean, if you're like me, like you're using like the basic dinar, every time, you know, the algorithm will go in the zone where the Taylor rule produces indeterminacy. That's going to be, you know, dinar will put a likelihood equal minus infinity there, so that you kind of excluding that zone. So perhaps someone will tell me, no, there's an option somewhere so that you can keep those ones. I'm sure, but that option is like well hidden in the fine print. So I don't think we should, you know, I think it's best to do two. And, you know, if you think, you know, and then one more thing. Either you really want to think in terms of, you know, like you want to think about monetary policy implementation, and that's very important to know whether, you know, you do this or that, you have a discount window, or you do that, or you brainwash journalists and then you do forward guidance. I mean, that's super important. But as far as, you know, modeling is concerned, well, in the end, what you do is that you pick up a trajectory for the interest rate. That's what you do. So let's write it directly as it is, you know, in equilibrium.
In the policy equation, why don't you put expectation of growth? Because we're talking about the US here and the Fed as a German.
Okay. So here the idea is that, you know, so that's, you know, D mu and nu is the state of the economy. So any rule that can depend on anything can be rewritten like this always. So it's just like, you know, this is a rule telling me, okay, I'm the central bank. I choose I minus ET of pi t plus 1. That's the interest rate. As a function of the state of the economy, which is here just the three shocks. So anything that is related to, you know, D affecting expectations, that's gonna show up in D in the end once you solve everything. That's the idea. So it's not easy to interpret in terms of implementation, but, you know, any allocation that you could get with those kind of complex implementation you would get here. Oh, anyway, okay. So that's what we estimate. And those three parameters, we will not estimate. This kappa, I told you, because we cannot. It's not identified. This beta, because, you know, the literature is not estimating it for a good reason, because then, you know, typically you get something which is negative or bigger than one. So you just kind of fix it. And this alpha y, we can, you know, it's, yeah. For identification, we could, you know, we cannot estimate everything. So we need to fix that one or that one, for example. Okay, so we decided, you know, to be what we call like quasi no Euler discounting. So it's kind of, it's like, it's think, you know, you can think of it as a one. If you put 0.999, it also works. Okay. So, you know, so it's as if we don't estimate it because it's one, but yeah. Okay. And so that's what we estimate. So when we do that, so again, you know, headline CPI minus unemployment gap. So same data. And here, that model is kind of cool because you can write the likelihood easily, so you can do maximum likelihood it works smoothly. Okay, that's a bit ugly, but, you know, I'm not showing everything. So the first equation is, you know, what we call the baseline. So let's look at that one. So we estimate like a lot of parameters, and, you know, out of the many, we estimate that this gamma y, which is the slope of the Phillips curve, and this gamma r, which is this cost channel. And so you see that typically here, you know, the slope of the Phillips curve is not significantly different from zero, and that guy is significant and different from zero. And finally, here we have all the parameters, so we can check the Patman condition, and it holds. Because I should tell you, if that guy is positive, it means that we are under Patman, meaning that a real interest rate hike will push up inflation. And then, you know, the rest, you don't want to know, but, you know, it's there. I mean, it's like all like changes in samples and variables, blah, blah, blah. And just have a look that this guy here is like, I mean, it's a bit hard to see, but it's never significant, and you know, the gamma R is always positive and significant. Then, okay, just to show you, you know, what's the impulse response to the three shocks here. So the first one, that's the response to the demand shock. You know, it looks like a demand shock. Inflation increases, you know, the nominal interest rate increases, and output gap increases. And if you look at I minus ET of pi t plus one, which is the real rate, it's also increasing, right? Okay. If you look at the other one, the markup shock, that's really it's an inflation shock. So basically what it does is that it increases inflation and doesn't affect the other variables. And then the third shock is the shock which is, you know, which is like the, if I were showing you only like the black lines, the two dark lines, it's a, you know, it's a shock to the real interest rate, a positive shock to the real interest rate. It's the monetary shock in that economy. And what it does is that you see it's very persistent. And that's a result I haven't shown you, but you know, the price puzzle is larger, the more persistent the shock is. And you see that that's the response of output. So you see that when there is an increase in the interest rate, there is indeed a decrease in output. That's what we have all the time. But inflation is going up. Okay. So what you have, if you don't have this Patman condition, the black line, the response of inflation will be negative on impact and going up. Okay. So in that model, you know, the Taylor rule that I can back up from the estimation of my like real interest rule is the following one. So it's a rule that wouldn't give you determinacy if you would put it to start with. So you know, so you can't find those results if you're estimating the model with the Taylor rule, because you're kind of putting too much constraint on the data. Unless you believe that, you know, that's exactly the way the central bank is kind of like conducting policy, and you know, yeah. And I mean, in the sense that, and that's exactly why that it's creating indeterminacy, because that's exactly the way it's conducting policy. Whereas what we say that, no, we're looking at like a choice of the interest rate. If you want to decentralize, if you want to operationalize this trajectory of the interest rate in terms of Taylor rule, that's what you need, the coefficients you need. Okay, so I think it's something we're working, you know, on an aside project now to understand, you know, how restrictive can it be to impose like a Taylor rule in those models. Okay, so now you can, you know, you can write down a model which is microfunded, where you have like habit persistence, this and that, I mean, a little bit more dynamics, and then you find, yes, now I remember why we do that. So, okay. No, okay. So here, you don't remember the gamma R, but you know, when you're estimating the Phillips curve, this gamma R was about like 0.2. Here it's like significant, but it's like 10 times lower. But the model is a bit crazy, because the model without any dynamics, right? So now when you do like a model which is a little bit more like, you know, bells and whistles, what you get is that this gamma R, you see it's in the territory of 0.1, 2.2. So it's kind of like more in line with the Phillips curve estimation, which is kind of not bad. And the slope of the Phillips curve is basically not significant, and if anything, negative. I hear identification is much more difficult to get with maximum likelihood. So here we do some kind of Bayesian method. Let me skip that. And that's the response. Okay, the response in that, you know, extended model. So you know, you have a little bit more dynamics, but you get the same thing. You know, look at demand and markup shocks. That's exactly what you would have in any model. But look at the last one. You know, a hike in the nominal interest rate is, which is like a tight monetary policy, is decreasing the output, but is pushing inflation up. Okay. Let me stop here. Thank you very much.
It just seems that in the first part of the talk, you told us that non-linearity is very important. And then at the end, we estimate a linear model, but we're not taking into account this strong non-linearity, where the response of interest rates has one effect, it's small, compared to a different sign, it's large.
Okay. Of course, I mean, what you understood is what I said, because the talk, but I don't think I said it's important to, even if this kind of pattern condition, or let's keep in mind kind of everywhere. That's what I was saying. So non-linearities might be important. What I take from the estimation of the Phillips curve, which we did also non-linearly, is that there's a kind of large range of values of R and output gap for which
you know, you can keep the linear approximation. That's what you get from this.
You use
the data,
use all the data, right? You don't use small
data. Yeah, no, but this, again, you know, the answer is like, it's really out of business. When estimating the Phillips curve, we do the full nonlinear thing. Because it's super easy, you just add like the nonlinear term. Doesn't change much unless you're like super fast. When we haven't done it for, we'll do it when you know, it needs me, but we haven't done it for the, in the kind of in the fully specified model. Yeah, I mean, I have like a little doubt that it, yeah. But I was clear, I mean, at the time of the Vietnam War, it's clear that, you know, it's very unlikely that pushing up the interest rate will not decrease infection, this kind of thing.
So, thank you. I want to apologize, I was late. Actually, I wanted to see Frank, so I went to the auditorium of the Banque de France. So, I had to be very fast in Paris, but you sent me your slide before, so I think I got many things you said. So sorry once again for being late today. Okay, this is a kind of a huge paper with many, many things, as you understood in the paper. And the claim is kind of big. We should think differently about monetary policy because we did not understand a huge channel, which is that actually real interest rates are affecting the marginal cost of firm. And actually, inflation is moving with the real interest rate in the wrong direction, I would say. Meaning that when you increase the real interest rate, you increase the marginal cost of firm, and so you increase inflation. So, and this is totally the opposite of the new Keynesian world we are familiar with. So, should we totally change the way we should think about monetary policy or not? That's a key question, otherwise. And so, let me first put the big thing and then go step by step in my discussion. I will not be that technical on the maximum likelihood estimation, stuff like that. Because I think there are things before that we should discuss. So, there are lots of criticism of low interest rate. Low interest rate are creating some problem about financial stability, asset prices, housing prices, things like that. And in the criticism of the low interest rate policy, there's a line of literature saying that actually low interest rate can cause low inflation because of some new channels we did not think about. And the Keynesian channel that you decrease interest rate and you stimulate demand may not work when interest rates are low for a long period of time. So there's a kind of some argument in this direction, and this paper is in this type of argument. There are three types of argument. The first is a kind of neo-Fisherian argument put forward in the debate by Cochrane, Schmidt-Grohe, and Uribe recently tried to convince that empirically that because of expectations, when people anticipate a permanent change in the nominal interest rate, as they think that the real interest rate will not move, inflation expectation adjust. And so when you decrease the nominal interest rate, you decrease expectation of inflation, and so you decrease actual inflation today. So because of the expectation channel, which is a key in the Fisherian definition of the link between the real and the nominal interest rate, you have the co-movement, which is in direction of low interest rate, create low inflation. There's a second line of argument going the same direction, which is the conclusion of Frank, which is the debate recently about income effects, put forward by some paper, mostly Eisenman focusing on Germany, saying that when real interest rates are low and you are in an aging society, people save for their retirement period. If you decrease the real interest rate, actually, you may increase the saving rate because people want an income in the future, which is what we call the income effect. And because of that, when you decrease the real interest rate, you do not stimulate demand, but you stimulate saving. Because of that, demand falls and inflation falls. Same direction. Third line of argument in the VSCO movement, the cost channel that Frank discussed. So, the cost channel, he said that the real interest rate is part of the marginal cost of firm. So when you decrease the real interest rate, you decrease the marginal cost of firm. And so you decrease the price setting decision of firm and you decrease inflation. So in this paper, there are two claims. It will come back, I hope. There are two claims. First, the direction is between when you decrease real interest rate or nominal interest rate, I will discuss that. So when you decrease interest rate, you discuss inflation. So that's the first claim. And the second claim, the channel is a cost channel and not the two other one. That's the two claim of the paper. You can buy one and not the other one. And in this presentation, Frank correlates the two, saying that this move in this direction is my channel. You see that maybe you should convince us that even if your empirical claim is right, the channel you focus is a good one. And so my gut feeling, when I look at the economy, I still think that low interest rates stimulate demand, many things. So this, for me, this is challenging to see, is Frank right and I'm wrong? Maybe this is maybe the most likely. But I want to be convinced. At this stage, I'm not fully convinced, and I will try to claim why. So the paper, Frank said many things. Basically, the key thing is that you put, so this is the marginal cost of firm on a quarterly basis, and actually depends on the level of output, because the more you produce, the costly it is because of decreasing return. There's a debate. The data return can be increasing, but forget about it. So this is a positive gamma y. And on top of that, you introduce the real interest rate in the marginal cost. And then this is a pricing decision of firm with the kappa, which is a standard parameter that relates current marginal cost, which are correlated with future marginal cost. And because you change price infrequently, when marginal costs are changing, when it's more costly to produce, you increase a little bit the price because you have monopolistic competition. That's a new Keynesian world we are familiar with. And you have the standard Euler equation. And the main result on the theoretical side is this Batman condition saying that things go in the wrong direction. When you decrease interest rate, you can actually decrease inflation because you decrease the marginal cost. Okay, and this is in the data. So in the paper, there are many things. Non-linear specification. This is very interesting, but it's not key. It's, for the theoretical side, it's true that it cannot hold globally the Batman condition. So there are lots of things. And it's the way I understand this is not key in the paper, even. It's some path dependency because Frank worked on nonlinear model. And then I think that this paper has a long history and we see the whole history in the paper. So it's very dense. So this part is not key. So I will not speak about it. And there are additional discussion that he explained that it's useful to think about the Mises deflation at the effective lower bound. He discussed monetary shock and there are various empirical estimation of gamma R. So, many things in this paper, very simple, a twist of the basic framework we are used to, and then a huge investment in estimation procedure to convince that this simple condition actually holds in the paper, in the data, sorry. So my discussion will be in three main things. First, two parts on the theoretical side, and then on the empirical one. So there's a lot of paper on the cost channel. There are many empirical papers, many theoretical papers. There's a huge literature. Ravana and Walsh has a normative paper, Suriko has paper, and I will quote some papers. Usually, and you will say that I'm kind of technical and speak about detail, but what I say, I think is not detail. Usually, when people modeled the cost channel of monetary policy in New Keynesian model. Usually what people say is the following. The firm has to borrow the wage bill one period in advance. And then in the marginal cost, there's a wage plus the borrowing cost, which depends on the interest rate. That's kind of a standard, I would say. But if you do that, what you find is actually the marginal cost does not depend on the real interest rate, but it depends only on the nominal interest rate. It's not a detail. It's key. Why it's key? Because Frank showed in various appendix that if this is true, is not it's this specification and not the real interest rate, then the Patman condition cannot hold on the theoretical side. You, although you estimate stuff, it has to be the real interest rate that is affecting the marginal cost. So Frank, he said, I will not speak about micro foundation, but there are lots of micro foundation in the appendix. So he provide the micro foundation where actually it's not the nominal interest rate here that affects the marginal cost, but it's the real interest rate which is affecting the marginal cost. So there exists a model in the space of model where his specification is a good one. But when you read the micro foundation, it's a Leontief. I will not go about it. You did not, so I will not spend some time on that. It's a Leontief production function where firm borrow in some intermediate goods the period before, and the intermediate goods are actually the final good of the period before. And because of that, you play a little bit with algebra. You can show that there exists a model with a Leontief production function with some intermediate goods which are borrowed one period in advance in terms of the final good, which depreciate 100% in the period. So you can produce a micro foundation where you get the reinterest rate. You get this specification with this term here. Okay? And a free parameter, which is here the real wage or the output gap. So I'm not a kind of a fanatic of micro foundation. But still, at the end of the day, the effects are huge that he finds. I will discuss about it. I would like to understand what are the channels about how come firms are so affected by the real interest rate? What are they really doing, actually? And I will elaborate on that. I think that for two reasons, your effects are so huge. And even if I believe in your result, there's some competing explanation, I think you could produce more convincing explanation of the direction of the cost channel. So, and this is what I started to do, but I did not have the time to go fully in this direction, is what additional piece of evidence do we have of the cost channel for monetary policy? And there's some empirical literature, the firm-Liebold thing that is there. And this is what we want to look at. I look at firms. So there's a paper on the US, which is not here. The two papers I quote are on Italian firm and German firm. So what they do, they try to estimate in the panel of firm the cost channel. It's there in the data. Firms are borrowing and it affects their pricing decision at the quarterly. But what I take from that, but it's hard, I did not have the time to fully try to map their coefficient with your gamma R. My first take on that is that this is kind of small what they find at the micro level. So then we are macroeconomists. So we know that the micro from the macro, there's some aggregation things. It's not that you take the micro estimate to put in the macro. But still, how can you map this high effect on the real interest rate on the pricing decision of firm of at the quarterly frequency with some microestimate? So I think it would be useful to see at least it's consistent in the space of parameter. I think it's key to convince that your channel is key. Second, once again, I like small model, but the cost channel is, in some paper, like Cristiano Evans, Akenbaum 2005, is related to investment. You do not have capital. So you have I think to be convincing that your effect is so big and that it's a real interest rate, at least an extension with a capital and not depreciation at 100% would be useful. I don't know how far you could go because you can do a lot of things, capacity utilization rate. But the real interest rate is affecting investment, it's affecting capital, and it affects the marginal cost through this channel. It would be great to plug your PC. So, last point on the theory side before I go on the... Okay, you recognize that you are not doing welfare analysis. Il va peut-être, bon. You are recognizing that you are not doing welfare analysis. You are focusing on the link between real interest rate and inflation. I think, and I, for this reason, I'm not sure that you should do it. But it's a question, general question. I think what you are claiming is the additional reason why we should keep interest rate low for a long period of time. Because it's good for firm, because it decreases the marginal cost of firm. So it may be good for investment, consumption, things like that. Although it can decrease inflation, but we do not really care about inflation. Inflation, people want to consume, to have a job, things like that. So I think what you are showing, the effect is so strong that that's an additional gain for low interest rate. So although the link between inflation and the interest rate is not a good one, maybe, the central bank should not change its policy or even go further in trying to decrease the interest rate because of welfare. This is what you have in your, the rest is even more interesting, so sorry for that. So the question of welfare, you put it aside. There's a literature on optimal monetary policy with the cost channel. Ravenna and Walsh, 2006, is about that. So maybe it's not, I don't know. I don't know if it's in this paper or not, but I think the welfare part is key because it's, at the end of the day, it's not a positive paper, it's a normative paper. It's a, should we do something different about monetary policy? I think it's there, the meat of the paper, the takeaway of the paper. So maybe we should not change monetary policy and accept low inflation because of the cost channel. At this moment, it's what I take from your paper in terms of policy. So let me move now to my two additional slides. Which are on empirical stuff. What you find is a huge effect of the real interest rate on the pricing decision. The gamma R, the term in front of the real interest rate, you have to look at me, otherwise you will be distracted. So the term gamma R, which is the effect of the real interest rate on inflation, is 0.2. And because it's so big, the Patman condition is fulfilled. When you estimate standard new Keynesian equation, the coefficient in front of the marginal cost, it's called kappa or lambda, depending on the textbook you read, the coefficient in front of the real marginal cost is 10 times smaller, 2%. So what you find in your various estimates, it's a huge effect of the real interest rate on the pricing decision firm, much bigger than the wage, than over marginal cost. How come the firm... So this lambda R, gamma R, include the fact that some firms are not pricing their standing their price all period, so the Calvo parameter is there. There are some firms which are forward-looking behavior, so they do not look at their current interest rate, things like that. So although you introduce all these additional things, you find such a huge effect. So it means that, I don't know, firms may borrow all their marginal costs, something like that. So, and it's there that to understand what's going on, linking it with at least some order of magnitude of what do firms borrow in the real world to understand the maximum effect of the interest rate, if they borrow anything, on marginal cost first to understand, and then on price would be useful. So, because the effect is so big, we want to analyze it deeper. And your empirical estimation is very nice, and I think we understood that you did many things, but there's still some debate about it. Because actually, what you consider is that you use either the CPI, Consumer Price Index, or the GDP deflator, or the price index of a personal consumption. I think the key index would be the producer price index. Why are not using the price of firm, the index of the price of firm, which is independent of the basket of consumption of household, which is what is at stake, the difference between two price index. So key index that we would love to have a regression at the to see the effect of reinterest rate on the pricing decision is the producer price index, the PPI. So I think it would be nice to double check that with this index, you get a result. Second, to go one step forward, it's very in the tradition of new occasion things, that very time series, things like that. But we have data on sector. I think you could use, even without using firm data, we have sector specific information about the price index and about some cost, some borrowing cost, things like that. I use some cross-section information to try to convince that indeed sector where you can see that indeed firms are borrowing more, indeed the price they put as a production is affected by the real interest rate in the direction you see. I think there are more information. You go very, very far in the time series dimension with lots of specification indeed, in stream mutation, things like that for the endogenous thing. I think there's a low-hanging fruit on the cross-section to see that you should see that in the cross-section. And we have lots of data on the cross-section with this very interesting thing you spoke about, which is national account. We have lots of sector things. So, to conclude, I push. Visitor. Ah, it's visitor.
You write visitor. No, you write visitor.
Ah, I write visitor, sorry. So there. So I will sum up because I will not redo everything with the slide. I think you get it. It's there in my discussion. So theory one, theory two, empirics. Okay, this is what I said. Using sector level information. And so let me conclude. This is a very good macroeconomics. It's not kind of a minor question that we are speaking about. It's really the key stuff about monetary policy and economic activity and the channel of the thing we think about it. It's very interesting. It's well done in many dimensions. And I can assure you there are lots of technical appendix with lots of extension to prove the claim that Frank has made. And my takeaway is that reading some empirical paper, it's there in the data, the cost channel. It's my understanding, sector firm literature is that it's not as big as the Batman condition holds. So I try to think about some endogeneity bias where you could get some big gamma R because I did not find it. So they're kind of a puzzle, what I claim. I do not understand that you get such a big effect and I do not understand where it could come from. So as I trust you, I think you're right, but still I'm not 100% convinced. So I think the proof is on my side. So it's still hard to believe. So, and I think it's the identification thing. So, and I think it's key. And so more information is always better and more information across section would help a lot. So that's my discussion. Thank you.
Okay. So let me be quick because we discuss more about it with a bit. Thanks a lot. So just maybe I can let me just discuss two. I agree with almost everything when that was a compliment. But just one thing, I'm trying to understand. So I lost my slide, Julia, is that it? No. It was there?
Yeah, it was there. Yeah.
No. That's the paper, the slide. I don't know, or maybe it is. Ah, yes, right. No, you're right. Let me just, because one thing which I thought was okay, but
okay, you know, the size is the size of the other size of the gamma not making any sense. So one thing that I try to say that, so that condition is really, it's a relative condition. It's really like gamma y over gamma r. So it's not something about like the absolute magnitudes. One and two, but you know, okay, let me take like the basic, because maybe there's an issue somewhere with the units or that, you know, when we estimate like the basic super basic equation, the first column, okay, so it's, you know, maybe it's ugly, but you know, so the gamma y, that's like 0.2, say. Then what, so that would be like the, in the new Keynesian model, that would be the cap, you know, what's called kappa. So here that would be 0.2. So you say it's 0.02. So here we have to kind of figure out what is, is y multiplied by 10. I mean, I don't see why it would be multiplied by 10, by 100, you know. So the idea is that, you know, whatever is the gamma r, it's about the same size that the gamma y when it's significant. So it's not something that is kind of like, kind of like pushing inflation in a crazy way compared to, so, you know, so it's not an answer to what you say, but what I thought from there, and is that, you know, yeah, no, that's really like that's the order of magnitude we should have, but, you know, so to be, I'll carefully kind of check, because if, you know, if something is wrong, it's wrong both on, you know, it's nothing wrong on the relative size. That's one. And two, which is also like very interesting. So maybe here, maybe a bit biased just because we did it that way, but okay. You know, it's like real versus nominal interest rate in the marginal cost. So I have another answer, which is perhaps a bit more convincing, but a bit ugly. So let me not use that one first. Okay. So now you know. If you're below 35, you basically don't know what's a flex price model. But you know, the very idea that in a model, I mean, that one could have like non-neutralities in a model is already like a bit like sometimes hard to accept for certain people also. But maybe in the short run, you know, I'm happy to believe that there's a little bit of non-neutrality in the short run. The fact that there would be some kind of non-neutrality in the long run in that world, so that the level of the nominal interest rate would have an impact on, on the level of output, you know, it's possible, but you really need to kind of like, I don't know. I mean, that's the way we did actually, but it doesn't mean that it's good. If you start writing a model which is a flex price model and you think of the cost channel, you know, by construction, you know, that would be the real interest rate. And then once you introduce, say, sticky prices, if you introduce only sticky prices, it's still going to be the interest rate. If on top of that, you introduce some kind of like, some frictions on financial markets, the fact that you cannot access to real bonds, but only nominal bonds. But that's a kind of yet another layer of friction, which, yeah, perhaps that's what we should do. But you know, it's kind of like, I think that, it's not about economics, by the way, we write economics, but if we kind of like think of like a flex price world and then add sticky prices only, you won't get like the nominal interest rate. Doesn't mean that it's not in the data. So, I mean, and then, you know, yeah, I'm not sure it's really interesting. It's, yeah, okay. That's the answer. Then there's a second answer, which is not, you know, as, which is either better or worse, is that, well, you know, provided that we do well the identification in estimating the Phillips curve only, whether it's the real or the nominal, it's just you see that it's a restriction on beta and kappa gamma r. You see, so you can test whether it's the nominal or the real attenters, provided that you have an idea of what should be beta. So, you know, it's kind of not perfect. But if you believe that the beta is at least 0.8, oops, I'm sorry, if you, then you end up having like the real and not the nominal. I'm not sure it's very clear, but you see that, okay, assuming that the real that it's the nominal rate that enters here is the same thing as assuming that beta plus minus gamma cap, gamma kappa gamma r is like 0.9, say, right? If you want the beta to be 0.9. I'm not doing it properly. I would need a blackboard, but okay. Anyway, you can see here that it's the same specification, but it's just the parameter that are, you know, it's you can test whether it's the real denominator. That's what I want to say, provided that you have a prior about what should be beta. Because of course, if beta can be anything, then you cannot tell, you know. And so we show that. that's it. But it's not, you know, it's not like black or white. It's not black or white. It's somewhere in the middle, a little bit more on the side of the real. But I'm not sure if I remember exactly, because there's an issue with like the expectations which are in the data about in 4 quarters and not in like in 1 quarter. So you need to also do some stuff. It's in the paper, I forgot, but it's something that, from the theory point of view, we really can started with like this, like real model and then sticky prices, but, and then you can test that. And so to come back to the initial question, is the real order nominal and is it too big? So again, you know, so the thing is that here, in a way, I don't know how to think about it. Again, you know, the identification is not perfect, but whatever we find here is more or less what's there, right? Those coefficients, those gammas. I mean, so you tend to think that identification can like seriously, I mean, misidentification can seriously bias those coefficients. That's true, but you know, I would kind of like think that it's pretty, you know, that's the best we can do for identification, and it's pretty robust with this. So it's long and not very well organized. So I'm sorry. So let me stop here. But a lot of things that I have to think to think of and more properly answer, you know, what you said. And then also like the other reasons for why you could have this kind of like you could have R affecting pi. That's clearly something we don't discuss in the paper, and it's a bit naive not to do that. Yeah. Sorry, it was long. Merci beaucoup. Thank you very much.